And today we're going to talk about top issues and abuses and misuses of just rigging in general. What's up, guys? My name is Devin, and welcome to another episode of The Table. Joining with me is Tom Horner, one of the corporate rigging inspection managers, and then Brian Holmgren as well, who's your regional rigging inspection manager, correct?
Yes.
And then Mike Close, one of our content managers here. And today we're going to talk about like top issues and abuses and misuses of just rigging in general. Does that sound good?
Absolutely.
Yeah, I mean, we brought the two of you guys in here because you're out in the field, you know, you're part of our inspection group, and you see a lot of equipment that's either been misused, been abused, is coming out of service, things like that. So we kind of just wanted to put together a list of some of the top problems you see when you're out in the field.
Number one problem, missing tag. People don't realize that a tag is required on just about everything. Everything requires different information on that tag, but the tag is required. That's required by OSHA for chains and ASME for all slings.
Is it stuff that's ripped off or stuff that just never had a tag or stuff that's just so jacked up that you can't see like what the label is? Like what kind of stuff are you seeing in the field?
Everything, but it's usually getting ripped off or it's getting heavily damaged or just wiped clean. But it's not that it didn't have a tag to begin with, it got ripped off. Synthetics, cuts and abrasion are a big one.
Discoloring, loss of their, you know, if you have a treated, which are usually a bright yellow. If they're not a bright yellow anymore, is it UV damage? Is it chemical damage? Mm-hmm. Is it heat damage?
You know, a lot of these guys will take and throw them in their solvent tanks because they get grease on them. Can't do that.
Okay.
Like just to wash them off?
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah, solvent will break the material down. Alloy chain slings, the biggest one probably is stretch bent links. Like Tom was saying, they think they'll lift the world because they're steel.
Right.
So grab a 9/32 chain and they'll load 10,000-15,000 pounds on there. So stretch bent links on chains.
And does that tie back to the first one where they're just not reading the tag to check the capacity?
Or they, like, you know, there's a misconception that there's extra capacity there.
Yeah.
That's a huge misconception.
This is a great one. I mean, what he's talking about is the safety factor.
Yeah, design factor and safety factor. So these people hear about design factors and safety factors and they say, as a matter of fact, we just had a customer that
this is great.
Told our rigging inspection coordinator that the last inspection group in there was telling them that working load is just there for reference, but there's a safety factor built in so they can go over that working load. And that's what they were telling them.
Right.
So they were rigging more than the working load.
Really what was happening is we're lifting to 100% plus because now we're thinking that this 4-to-1 gives us over 100%.
Mm-hmm.
And that was coming from another inspector from another organization, which is why we received the phone call immediately.
Do you guys see anything with wire rope and wire rope slings?
Broken wires is the biggest one. Corrosion's another big one with wire rope.
Kinks.
Kinks are a misconception. Some people think a kink is a kink or isn't a kink. Dog legs.
Right.
But yeah, some people think just because they have a little curve in their rope, it's called a kink, but it's not a kink. A kink is when you actually take a rope and you twist it around and go and pull it against itself and you try to pull the circle out, the loop out.
Mm-hmm.
That becomes a kink.
And so I shot a video with Tom Coral the other day and he was kind of demoing like a 7-part and how durable and flexible it is. And then he had this other different, I guess the capacity was higher. So he picks it up and it's just at all these different angles and it's all sharp or whatever. And he was saying that it didn't necessarily mean that that rope was bad. You could still rig it. Obviously a lot more difficult to get it on a hook because of all the different angles and stuff and rig it properly. It had kinks all over the place, but it looked like it was bad to me, but he said that one was, it was actually safe.
Right. Because all inspection is subjective. What I always went by is if I could clearly tell that deformation is not gonna come out under load, then I'm failing it.
You
and know, it's real easy to come up to something you can say that's not, you know.
That's the biggest thing.
It's an L.
Put a light load on it and see if it comes out.
Okay.
You know, not this, but if you can tell.
Sure. Yep.
You know, if you can just tell it's going
to
come out.
So say it's bad and say you start to pull it. What does it do versus what is it, you know, supposed to do? Does it completely straighten out into a straight line?
It should straighten out.
And if it doesn't, if it still has a couple grooves, is that where you know, like, all right, there's something wrong here?
What you've done is you've literally... So wires need to pull against themselves. They need to be able to move, kind of just like a nylon. So if you've put a curve in it, now you've created a... What is that? Resistance for the wires to be able to move.
Okay.
So, once you put a load on it and you can see that there's still a kink in it or a dog leg in it, now you need to pull it out.
Rigging hardware, which goes, you know, with the rigging, what we're talking, shackles, eye bolts, hoist rings, items like that. They all have different requirements, but what you see there is basically the same thing you'll see on the slings. Eye bolts misused, so you come in and they're bent or they're chopped in half or somebody did something and welded them and made some sort of a configuration, and shackles with incorrect pins and, you know, stretch shackles and worn things and, you know, all that thing. Hoist rings that are locked up and frozen because they've been overloaded and you can't, you know, rotate your threaded stud piece, your bolt, I should say. I'll be driving down the road and I'll see a construction site and I'll see stuff hanging off the crane and I'm looking for a tag. I'm looking for a tag. I'm like, this is construction. You know, they're number one. You're like, where's your... And you can clearly see when there's no tag. It's like the culture is either checking off a box or we really care.
Right.
It's like there almost is no in between from what I've ever seen.
No.
You can't really go halfway, right, either. You're just going to do it to fulfill your requirements.
Is it tough for people in certain organizations? I guarantee it. Is it easier for people in other organizations? I guarantee it, because we're seeing an advancement finally in the realization of what this looks like. Mm-hmm. You know, customers are really starting to get the big picture now.
Kind of to close it up, I think we've talked about lifting slings, we've talked about hardware. The last kind of component of that is below the hook lifting devices. And there's all kind of, you know, spread beams, lifting beams, C-hooks, all kinds of stuff. What are some of the common problems you see there?
These beams are huge, they're massive. They can be same as an alloy chain sling. It looks like it's indestructible. Mm-hmm. So they really take it to the limits. Sometimes they smash them right against the crane. And I mean, literally, I've seen cranes where the cranes, you know, smashed in where they took the lifter up too high and, you know, caved the lifter right into the crane. And
jeez.
Deformation probably.
I'm going to go with homemade. You know, in the world of slings, it's, you know, people have, today, generally, you don't find as many homemade items as you used to, but with the below the hook. Because it's such an evolving world and everything is so custom.
Right.
Everything is custom. Mm-hmm. So we understand there's some generic stuff out there in the world, but almost everything is custom to a lift and an application, lifting this unit and putting it over here. So you're going to see the homemade stuff. You're going to see the tagging, because tagging, these, like Brian said, they take abuse, and these tags are often just like cheaply riveted on. You can't just simply test and re-tag a below-the-hook device.
Yeah.
It's not like anything else. OSHA's just the body that's going to come question you.
Mm-hmm. And find you.
More importantly, right. Find you.
But what we're saying is these ASME, where we live, that's where we want our customers to live.
Right on.
Yeah.
You know, we want to help you, you'll be there and apply it to your facility.
Right. Yeah, OSHA, they really do defer to the experts. There's all these little micro organizations that live with all these industries. You've got CMAA.
Yes.
OSHA refers to CMAA. You've got NEC for their grounding requirements. So they really do just kind of...
they enforce.
Yeah.
They're just right. They're just
But
off.
They defer to these other organizations that are equipped to actually write the standard.
Yes.
Absolutely.
So yeah, that is a good misconception, kind of.
Well, the one thing I was thinking about when we were kind of talking, just to close this out, is you can be selfish with your safety, really, but there's no reason that anybody who's watching this stuff can't educate themselves. And that's it, and it's just that easy. So if you're going online, you're looking at the blogs and stuff we put together, you're on the YouTube channel, you're checking out the videos, but you can also contact these guys if you guys have any questions, if you're not sure about the stuff that you're lifting, if you just need help, or if you have questions, or if you're pretty sure that something isn't correct, wouldn't you rather make a phone call to these guys and say, hey, I need you to check this out, as opposed to just going for it and hoping it all works out? Their whole team can help you with all that stuff. So Tom, Brian, Mike, I really appreciate your time. I think this was a really good conversation, really interesting conversation, and really beneficial conversation that can help you and your team stay safe in the future. So my name is Devin McCarty. For all of us at Mazzella Companies, thank you for watching.